सो डॉक्टर प्रदीप गोयल सर हेड ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट एसएमएस मेडिकल कॉलेज एंड अटैच हॉस्पिटल इन द फेशियल प्लास्टिक सर्जरी डिपार्टमेंट. सर नाउ प्लीज गो एट सर प्रदीप गोयल सर.
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द सेकंड मीटिंग ऑफ रैनल प्लास्टिक सोसाइटी ऑफ इंडिया and this Dr. Sunil is the secretary of founder secretary of Rhinoplasty Society of India, and he has done his MSGen ENT and will be presenting his lecture on surgical anatomy of nose. He did masters in rhinoplasty from USA and fellowships in rhinoplasty from Alexandria University of Egypt. Right now, he is the director of Nux Rhinoplasty Center in Jaipur. Along with that, he also running a fellowship course from that Nux Center and the founder secretary of Rhinoplasty Society of India. Please welcome Dr. Sunil for his presentation. Thank you very much.
So thank you, sir, for kind, nice words, and thank you for nice introduction. So I share my screen. So today my topic of talk is the surgical anatomy of the nose in rhinoplasty. This is a very basic basic talk, because in these days there is a lot of webinars on the rhinoplasty and very fantastic lectures on the rhinoplasties. But I personally realized that we need some basic talks like on the anatomy and the nose analysis or something. So I choose this topic for today. Now, these are the just. So challenges of rhinoplasties, like why the rhinoplasty is most difficult operations? Because in all aesthetic surgery, the rhinoplasty is the most difficult operations. So there are certain reasons. The first reasons that the highly variable nasal anatomy, because look that the nose have the endless anatomic variations. So in every nose, there is something different anatomy. And the second, the reason that the procedure must need the form and functions. In other surgery, there is no need to the form and function both. But in rhinoplasty, the procedure must need the form and function. And the final result match with the patient expectation. This is the most difficult aspect also. So these all three reasons make the rhinoplasty the most difficult operations. So the patient's persistence and consistency is the pathway of the victory, that like this. So the doctor, the person need the continuous patience and persistence. So for a successful rhinoplasty, we need the basic three steps for successful rhinoplasty. First, the selection of the correct patient. Hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Go ahead. So, we are here. Your voice is clear.
So the first
with your talk.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, sir. So the first important step is the selection of the correct patients. This is the most important step. You are a good rhinoplasty surgeon and your skills is very good, but if your selection of the patient is not good, then it's very difficult to satisfy the patient. So the selection of the patient should be important step. So your patient should be primarily motivated, not secondary motivated. And after thorough examination, you determine that either your patient is know about the realistic outcome for the surgeries. And another important thing, that is the comfort zone of the surgeon. Your selection of the patient is good, but the comfort zone of the surgeon is also an important step. If a beginner or a new rhinoplasty surgeon do a case successful, then he boost up their confidence. But in the initial days, if he do the complicated case and the result is not good, then it down his confidence. So the selection of the correct patient and the comfort zone of the surgeon is the first important step. And then second important step, that is the pre-operative planning. Good pre-operative planning. By good pre-operative planning, we identify what underlying deformity patient have. So for good pre-operative planning and this for this second step, we need the background knowledge of the nasal anatomy and the nasal aesthetics and the nasal analysis. So we formulate a surgical plan. So today we discuss about the nasal anatomy. Now, for study of the nasal pyramid, for study of the anatomy of the nose, we divide the nose in different components. So the outer soft tissue envelope and the inner framework. The outer soft tissue framework and the outer soft tissue envelope and its associated landmark. And this soft tissue envelope that cover the inner framework of the nose. So we can divide the nose in the upper vault and the mid vault and the lower vault. And from the top to bottom, there is the septum. So these are the different component of the nasal pyramid. So one by one, we discuss. Okay, so the most important thing for the surgical landmark regarding the bony pyramid. So the surgical landmark regarding the bony pyramid is the first is the glabella. The glabella is the most prominent point on the midline. So important muscles arise from this glabella, that is the procerus. And this is an important point where we measure the important aesthetic angle, also nasofrontal angle, and we measure from measure the forehead length also from this glabella to the tracheon. The tracheon, that is the central part of the forehead on of the anterior hairline. And another the important surgical landmark, that is the root of the nose, the radix. Radix is the distance of the frontonasal suture, but on deepest point of this frontonasal suture, that is the nasion. So nasion is an important landmark. We measure an important aesthetic angle also from the nasion, and it fall on the supratarsal hairline, and the glabella, that is fall on between this eyebrow. And the another important point, that is the rhinion. So rhinion is the osteocartilaginous junction, and two important thing regarding the rhinion, that is the first, that is the skin thickness. The skin thickness on the entire the dorsum, that the thinnest in the rhinion area. So there is great care should be taken during the dorsum dissections, because this is the area where we have the maximum chance of the injury due to the thinnest skin. Another important point regarding the rhinion, a very important area on the, below the this rhinion, that is the K area, that is the junction or confluence of this nasal bone, upper lateral cartilage, and the bony septum and the cartilaginous septum. So in the K area, this nasal bone overlap maximum the upper lateral cartilage. So this upper lateral cartilage get maximum support from the K area. So you always maintain the integrity of this area, because if this area is disrupted during the rhinoplasty, during the osteotomy, then it's very difficult to reconstruct it. So these are the important landmark bony regarding the bony pyramid. Now, the another landmark regarding the cartilaginous vault, that is this entire is the nasal lobule. So the most projected part in the nasal lobule, that is the tip lobule. So on either side of the tip lobule, there is two light reflecting area. That is the tip defining point. So the distance between the tip defining point, this is the width of the tip. On either side of the tip defining point, this fibrofatty tissue structure, that is the ala of the nose, this one. And between this column like structure, that is the columella. And where the columella end, where the columella start and the tip end, then this part is the infratip break. So the area between the tip defining point and the infratip break, that is the infratip lobule. And another on the dorsum. Another on the dorsum, where the tip end and the I think someone microphone is on, so I think I just mute.
Please mute your microphone.
I mute all then. Okay. So now this from the tip defining point to the this supratip break, that is the supratip part of the tip. Now, on where this ala attached with the cheek and the lip. So this part, the attachment of this ala with the cheek, that is the ala facial groove and the base of ala. And this part just medial to this columella, this cylindrical area, this is the seal of the nose. So, and another important thing, the excessive, this is the curvature of this ala, that is the ala flaring. So if you want to reduce the ala flaring, then we excise this ala base area. And if you want to reduce the size of the nostril, then we excise the seal area. And this another important point. This important point, that is the soft triangle area at the apex of the vestibule. So this soft triangle area is important area. In the soft triangle area, very skin to skin approximations and very few scanty subcutaneous tissue. So during the marginal incision, if there is injury in this soft triangle area, then the post-operative period, the patient develop the notching, because it's a important anterior boundary of the external nasal wall. So great care should be taken during the marginal incision and preserve the soft triangle area. Another landmark, that is the dorsal aesthetic line. So if we made this medial part, medial most of the eyebrow to the tip defining point, these are dorsal aesthetic lines. So the dorsal aesthetic line, they show the contour of the dorsum. So these are the important surgical landmark. Now, the soft tissue envelope. This soft tissue envelope have the skin and the subcutaneous tissue. Skin have the epidermis and the dermis. The dermis have the variable thickness in the upper third, mid third, and the lower third. And another is the subcutaneous tissue. So the composition of the subcutaneous tissue, they divide into the four layer. One is the superficial fatty layer, and then the smears and the deep fatty layer and the periosteum and the perichondrium. So this superficial fatty layer that have the adipose tissue layer. So this layer have the fibrous septas. So this layer connect this smears layer to the dermis, and this have the multiple fibrous septa. Another, the second layer, that is the smears, that is the fibromuscular layer, that this smears layer, this integrate the force of contraction of the muscles through this smears into the dermis layer. And Another, that is the third, that is the deep fatty layer. This is the thinnest layer of the subcutaneous tissues. And the important thing regarding this deep fatty layer, it does not have any fibrous septa. So it facilitates the movement of this inner framework, and it have the nerve supply and the vascular supply of the nose. So the plane of the dissections, that's why the plane of the dissection is the below SMES. So it maximizes the blood supply of the flap and minimize the blood loss, especially in the secondary case, there have the already the blood supply is the compromised. And then the last, that is the periosteum or the perichondrium, the covering of the bony pyramid, that is the periosteum, and the cartilaginous vault covering, that is the perichondrium. That is the perichondrium. So if we compare the thickness, then the upper one third, then the upper third in the nasofrontal area, the thickness of the soft tissue is the thickest and more mobile. And the thickness of the soft tissue envelope in the rhinion area is the thinnest. And in the lower third is the highly variable due to the sebaceous glands. So definitely the quality of the skin thickness is either the thick or either the thin. It ultimately affects the outcome of the surgery. Now, suppose if the patient have the thin skin, if the patient have the thin skin, then first the important thing, how we recognize the preoperative if the patient have a thin skin. So when a patient have the thin skin, the appearance of the skin is the pale and it freckled. So first we identify the thin skin, and the thin skin patient have the limited subcutaneous tissue. So there is no concern to the camouflage for the contour irregularities. And later there is a tendency to the contract postoperatively. So irregularities in underlying structure will show with time and further show imperfection. So when you do the work on the thin skin, then do near the perfect surgery to achieve the desired outcome. And the cartilage graft must be refined through the beveling and the margin, beveling the margin and the morselizations. So later we can prevent the camouflage irregularities. And we use the fascia graft for thickening soft tissue envelope and the camouflage irregularities on the used cartilage graft and on the dorsum. So and they camouflage the irregularities later. So these are the effect of thin skin. Now, on the other hand, if the patient have the thick skin, when the patient have the thick skin, then definitely we have the advantage, because the thick skin patient have a lot of cushion to camouflage the irregularities. So it masks the minor irregularities, and the graft material better tolerated, and there is less chance of the graft visibility. So this is the advantage when the patient have the thick skin. But on the other hand, when the patient have the thick skin, then definitely we have the disadvantage also, because the thick skin have a memory. So it does not readily adapt to changes in the nasal framework, and we need a lot of work to change the appearance of the nose, and greater amount of the work we need to change the appearance of the nose. So this is the disadvantage of the thick skin, because the mostly Indian patient have the thick skin. So effect of outcome, basically, if for a thick skin patient, for the more refining, we reducing the cartilaginous framework. So when we reduce the cartilage framework, then it buckle and collapse of the cartilage due to the force of the healing and scar contracture later. And another important thing, when we build up underlying strong framework for more defined.
Hello, look. Dr. Sunil.
Yes,
can
sir.
I interrupt you for a minute?
Yes, sir.
There are both persons are waiting for the webinar. Can you let him?
Okay. I admit all now, I think.
Okay, thank you, thank you.
Now I think no one is waiting. So the second important thing, when we build up the underlying stone framework for getting the more definition, then there is a problem sometimes. We find a bigger notch, but patient do not want the bigger notch. So the important thing, it become important to structure the notch without increasing the size dramatically. And another important thing, that we resist the temptation to aggressively reduce the underlying cartilage. So these are the two important things when we do the work on the thick skin patients. This is the method by which we can debulking the thick skins. So in this methods, we hold the skin and give counter pressure by the thumb and index finger. This is the debulking method, the by the plucking of the thick subcutaneous tissues. Sometimes there is some bias that in this technique there is chance of the subdermal there is skin necrosis, but we do work on the only in subcutaneous work. There is we don't disturb the skin, so there is no chance of the skin necrosis, and we avoiding penetration of the subdermal plexus within the subdermal fat. Some people use after the infiltrations by the seizure, they remove the subcutaneous. That is also a good technique. But for the beginners, this debulking of the thick skin method for thinning skin is the good methods. Now the muscle of the notch. Again, I admit all one. So the muscle of the notch we can divide in the three main groups. One is the elevator muscles, another is the depressor muscles, and the compressor muscles. So in the elevator muscles, the procerus muscles and the levi superioris muscles, when these muscles contract, then they shorten the nose and dilate the nostril. And another, the depressor muscles, that this transverse nasalis muscles, this just I admit. So this transverse muscles have the two part. One is the transverse part and other is the LR part. So this LR part, when the contract with the depressor septi nasalis, then they lengthen the nose and dilate the nostril. And another muscles, the transverse portion, then they contract, then they lengthen the nose and the narrow nostril. So these are the different muscles of the nose. Admit mere ko karna pad raha hai isme. So the three muscles have the significant effect on the rhinoplasty. Out of all these muscles, one is the depressor septi nasalis muscles. So due to the overaction of these muscles, sometimes the patient produce the tip drop during the smiling of the patient, and the patient produce the tanging in the membrane septum during the deep inspirations, because these muscles arise from the incisive fossa of the maxilla and insert from the membranous part of the septum. So the typically the patient complained that, oh doctor, whenever I smile that my nose is droopy. So this is the knowledge of the anatomy. If you don't know the anatomical knowledge, how can we recognize the problem of the patient? And another important, the second muscle, that is the procerus. This procerus muscles, this arise from the radix area and insert from the caudal part of the nasal bone. So during the dissection, sometime this muscle is injured. So it contract and obliterate this nasofrontal angle area. Because ideally for aesthetic, good aesthetic appearance, we have this aesthetic nasofrontal angle between the forehead and the dorsum of the nose. So when this muscle is contract, then it fills the nasofrontal angle area and it produces a Gracian profile postoperatively. So this is the importance of this procerus muscles. Now the nasalis muscles, this nasalis muscles have the two, we already discussed that two part. So if the transverse part is injured, then it can cause scar and the dimpling formation on the dorsum, because the transverse part of this nasalis basically spin and cover the upper lateral cartilage, and it gives the blanket effect on the upper lateral cartilage. So if this part is injured, then it can cause the scar and dimpling formation on the dorsum. The another part, that the LR part of the transverse muscles, if injured, then it can cause collapse of the internal nasal wall and develop the internal external nasal wall insufficiency. So this is the importance of the muscles. Now, supply of the nose. The blood supply of the nose comes from the two system. One is the ophthalmic system and other is the facial artery system. So from the ophthalmic system, there is a terminal branch of the ophthalmic artery, that is the dorsal nasal artery. So its dorsal nasal artery emerges from the medial part of the orbit and run over the anterior surface of the nasal bone towards the nasal tip. And it supplies the upper part of the nose and it contributes the subdermal plexus. Now, the another part from the facial artery system, this facial artery gives the two branches. One is the superior labial artery and another is the angular artery. So this superior labial artery run along the upper part of the lip, and at the base of columella, it gives some branches, that is the columellar arteries. And this angular artery, that is the terminal branch of the facial artery, at the level of alofacial groove, it gives some branches, that is the lateral nasal arteries. So this lateral nasal artery run upwards, and this lateral nasal artery and branches of the superior labial artery, columellar vessels, have the anastomosis on the lower part of the LR cartilage. So that is the LR arcades. And some branches of the lateral nasal arteries have anastomosis with the dorsal nasal artery, that is the subdermal plexus. So this is the blood supply of the nose. But now the importance of this blood supply of the nose, that especially during the filler injections. During the filler injection, there is risk of the blindness. Then sometimes when we inject the filler, then due to the reverse embolization, during the filler injection, the filler reach through the anterior and the posterior ethmoidal arteries, ultimately reach in the ophthalmic artery, in the central artery of the retina, that is the end artery. So the patient developed the blindness, and in a study, there is a 98 case is reported. So when we inject the filler in the this radix area, then around the 38% chance of the maximum chance of the blindness. So there is many ways to prevent these complications. We inject slowly and incrementally, and inject in the correct depth and plane, and in-depth working knowledge of the vascular anatomy. And if bad luck we have happened this one, then must have the management strategy also. So during the filler injections, it's important about the about the correct depth and the plane. Another, that during the transcolumellar incision, in open approach, when we made an incision in the transcolumellar incision, then we injured the columellar vessels. So now the supply of the tip and its flare is dependent on the lateral nasal arteries. So sometimes during the LR-based incision in the same patient, we preserve the lateral nasal artery during the procedure, because LR-based incision should not more than 2 mm. Otherwise, there is chance of the damage of this lateral nasal artery. So this is the importance of the this incision in the alabes excision. Another important thing that the during defattening of the nasal tip, if someone do the aggressive defattening of the nasal tip, then that should be avoided to prevent vascular compromise of the nasal tip. So this is the importance of the blood supplies. Like the lower incision, that is not more than 2 mm outside this alofacial groove. Otherwise, there is chance of the injury of the lateral nasal arteries. So these are the important thing that we can prevent the complications if we have the thorough anatomical knowledge. Because during the transcolumellar incisions, we already injured the columellar vessels. So entire blood supply of the tip and this flap is dependent on the branches of the lateral nasal arteries. So whenever we do, then we always keep the mind for the anatomy. Now, after the study of the soft tissue envelope, the muscles of the nose and the blood supply of the nose, the inner framework, the bony pyramid. So the bony pyramid that is consist by a pair of nasal bone. So this nasal bone, the attachment of the nasal bone, this nasal bone attached superiorly with the nasal process of the frontal bone and the frontal process of the maxilla. So the understanding of the anatomy of the nasal bone, the philosophy of the nasal bone, the two important things, one is the shape of the nasal bone and another is the thickness of the nasal bone. So if we measure the width of the nasal bone in nasofrontal suture area, then around in this area, the width of the nasal bone is around the 14 millimeter. And if we go in the nasofrontal area, then around is the 10 millimeter. And if we go down, then 10 to 12. So the shape of this nasal bone is just like a hourglass pattern. So due to the shape of this nasal bone, we have a shadow on the dorsum, shadow of the dorsal aesthetic line. Another important thing that the thickness of the nasal bone. The nasal bone in nasofrontal suture area, the thickness that is around the 5 to 7 millimeter. But if we go gradually down, then the thickness is around the 2.5 mm. So this part of the nasal bone is the thickest. So this part is act as a cantilever and it gives the support to this nasal bone and the upper lateral also. So this dense part of the nasal bone, whenever we deal with the nasal bone in osteotomy or any procedure, then we never enter in this dense part of the nasal bone. Otherwise, we develop the complications. Another important thing that regarding the bony pyramid, that is the piriform aperture. This piriform aperture is the external bony opening of the nasal cavity. So the upper and lateral margin of this piriform aperture that is formed by this nasal bone and the frontal process of the maxilla, and on the lower border margins there is this projected structure on the body of maxilla, that is the important structure, that is the nasal spine, anterior nasal spine. So this anterior nasal spine is important structures because the posterior part of the caudal septum attached through this anterior nasal spine. So sometimes if a caudal septum is dislocated and in the crooked nose, then we reconstruct the septum in the midline and we suture through this anterior nasal spines. Some person use a burr hole, or I think the easy method, we can suture by a 40 PDS suture through the periosteum of the anterior nasal spine. And another important thing regarding the anterior nasal spine for the projection or the deep projection. Sometimes if we need the projections, then we use like the clamping graft and the premaxillary graft in the antenasal spine area. Or if we want to the deproject the nose, then we reduce the nasal spine. So this is the importance of the antenasal spine. And another, sometimes this antenasal spine is underdeveloped, like in the Binder syndrome and in non-Caucasian people, like this antenasal spine is underdeveloped. So these are the important thing regarding the bony pyramid. Now, the clinical pathology of this bony pyramid. So the for the clinical pathology, the nasal bone exhibit the great variability in the length and the width. Sometimes this nasal bone have the short nasal bone, short length. So when the nasal bone have the short, then it's very difficult and it's challenging during osteotomy, because when the nasal bone is short, then upper lateral cartilage is long. So during the osteotomy, this nasal bone, due to the fragmentations, it precipitate the nasal obstruction, because when the nasal bone is short, then upper lateral cartilage is long. So during the osteotomy, because the upper lateral cartilage is lost their support, so there is inferomedially collapse of this upper lateral. So the patient consequently develop the inverted V deformity. The patient develop the inverted deformity. So I again repeat the inverted V deformity. Then when the patient have the short nasal bone and the long upper lateral, then during the osteotomy, this upper lateral have lost their support. So there is inferior medial collapse of this upper lateral. So the patient develop the inverted V cosmetic deformity. Other deformities regarding the bony pyramid, because we have the only one way to correct the bony pyramid, that is the osteotomy. So regarding the pathway of the osteotomy, these are other anatomical deformities, like the pathway of the osteotomy. Initially, when the osteotomy is start by the Joseph, then the osteotomy from the lowermost piriform aperture to the uppermost part of the nasal bone is the same pathway. So consequently, later the patient developed the functional and the cosmetic deformity. The Webster realized these things. So he realized that rather than go from the lowermost, if we go little bit higher towards the dorsum, that is the high, low that's towards the maxilla. So this triangular area is important. We can preserve this triangular. That is the Webster triangle area, because in this Webster triangle area, there is attachment of the lateral part of the upper lateral and the head of the inferior turbinate. So if we damage this part of the this bony vase triangular part, then there is a more chance of the postoperatively medial collapse of the head of inferior turbinate and the upper lateral. So the consequently, the patient develops airway problem. Another, ideally, the pathway through the ascending process of this maxilla. And if we do the more medial, then the patient develops the step of deformity. So ideally, the osteotomy through the ascending process of the maxilla. And another anatomical deformity, that is the open roof deformity. So when we remove the hump, then there is a space created between the septum and then the upper lateral and nasal bone, that is the open roof deformity. And these are the other deformity, like the hump or the saddling or the deviation or the crooked nose. So these are the clinical anatomical and pathology of the bony pyramid. Now the mid vault. The mid vault basically composed from a pair of the upper lateral cartilage and the dorsal nasal septum. So this upper lateral cartilage is a important, because it is subserving cartilage, because it connect the upper third and the lower third. So it acts as a bridge. And this upper lateral cartilage have the two margins. One is the medial margin and the lateral margin. Because this upper lateral is the triangular cartilage and it spanning laterally and forms the lateral boundary of the mid vault. So the medial part of this, the medial margin of this upper lateral attached with the septum at a specific configuration at around the 10 to 15 degree angulation, that is the internal nasal valve area. So the maximum airflow from this internal nasal area, internal nasal valve area, and have the maximum airway resistance. So during the rhinoplasty, we always maintain the integrity of the internal nasal valve area, or we recreate by the spreader graft or by the different other maneuver, and we preserve this internal nasal valve area during the rhinoplasty. Another, we discussed already the this Webster triangle area. This is the bony wedge area just lateral to the at the anterior end of the inferior turbinate. So the lateral most part of this upper lateral attached with this Webster triangle area. So if we damage this part of the Webster triangle area, then the upper lateral cartilage is the medialized and the head of inferior turbinate is medialized. So the patient consequently the develop the functional problem. Now another important thing, the septal angle area is also, so the anterior septal angle, the angle between the dorsal border and the caudal part of the septum. So at the disjunction, this is the anterior septal angle area. This is an important area because this is the first area after the degloving the nose, when we degloving the septum. So this is the first area we start the dissections for the septum in the open approach, and it's very difficult. So keep patience for my junior colleagues, because when we start the dissection in crooked nose and in deviated septum or in young age. So this is the septal angle area, and sometimes if in this anterior septal angle area, if we there is a residual hump, then the consequently the post operative the patient develop a polybic deformity, and if we we leave the residual tissues. And these are the risk factor for the abnormal mid vault, like the short nasal bone, then weak and the long upper lateral cartilage, and the thin skin, and the tension nodes deformity, and the pre op the positive caudal stretch. Then these are the risk factor for the abnormal mid vault. Now this is the clinical pathology of the mid vault. This is a different type of the deformity, anatomical deformity, like the inverted V deformity. We already discussed the crooked mid vault and the middle vault collapse and the open rib deformity. So these are the cosmetic deformity that related with the mid vault. Another, that the functional nasal obstructive symptoms due to the if there is a problem in the internal nasal valve area, and the polybic deformity. If there is excessive scar tissue due to the undercorrection of the cartilaginous dorsum at anterior septal angle area, then the patient develop the polybic deformity. So the mid vault reconstruction by the different type, like dorsal only graft, if the patient have saddling or the collapsed dorsum, and the spreader graft and the auto spreader flap and the flaring sutures, we by these methods we reconstruct the mid vault. Now the lowermost vault, the lower vault that consists by the bony skeleton and the cartilaginous framework. So the bony skeleton, that is formed by the maxilla and the nasal spine, and the cartilaginous framework, that is by the a pair of the lower lateral cartilage and the caudal septum, then the soft tissue envelope and the loose areolar tissues. So these are the component of this nasal lower third lobule. Now these are the different sub unit of the nasal tip, like the tip lobule, the ala lobule, and the columella, and the nostril, and the vestibule. So these are the different subunit of, but in the different subunit of the nasal tip, there have configurations like this. This tip have the upper one third part, and then this the columella have the lower two third. So there is a relationship of the tip defining point. There are certain relationship in the all structure. The tip defining point, this ideally the distance between the tip defining point for a male patient is the around 4 to 6 millimeter. Sometimes if there is a due to the over type suture or the overly placed tip graft, then there is a single point tip. So the patient develops the tent deformity. So this is the tent deformity, it's anatomical deformity due to the overtight suture. And another important thing, there is a relationship between this ala part and the and the columella. This columella should hang just inferior to this ala ring. So this is the gull in wing appearance. So this relationship is important when we assess in the frontal view in the patient. Another, that is the columella show. So the columella show, that the anatomical component of the columella show, that is the nostril border, then the caudal septum and the medial crest and the antenasal span. So this ala and the columella have the certain relationship. Whenever we examine the patient, then we assess first the normal anatomy, then we correct the abnormal anatomy. If we know the normal anatomy, then we correct the abnormal anatomy. Now, the LR cartilage. This LR lower one third that consists by this LR cartilage. So this LR cartilage have the three part. The medial most part of this LR cartilage, that is the medial crest, and the lateral most part, that is the lateral crest, and the part connect, that's two part, that is the intermediate crest or the middle crest. So this medial crest and the middle crest, this again have the two part, again have the two part. So we discuss one by one this medial crest. This medial crest is a primary component of the columella. And because it gives a pillar, it acts as a pillar on which the nasal tip rests. This part is divided in the two part. One is the foot plate and other is the columella part. This foot plate gives the support to this in this tip. And this foot plate basically rests on the fatty tissues at the base of the columella. But sometimes in the advancing age or after the trauma, after the surgery, the fatty tissue may get reabsorbed. So the patient develop that drooping tip postoperatively. So these important thing, when we examine the patient, then we always assess these things. And another important thing, this part, that is the columella part. So this columella part is an important landmark whenever we in the open approach, whenever we, after the transcolumella incision, whenever we open the, when we raise the transcolumella flap, then this is the first structure we identify, and it gives a landmark for the further dissections. Now, the caudal septum and the medial part is have a particular relationship. For ideally, the pleasing appearance of a normal caudal septum, this medial crest, this caudal septum protrude 2 to 4 millimeter in the medial crest. But sometimes, if then more than this, then this is the hanging columella appearance, and nose is over projected. And if the caudal septum is less than this, then the retracted columella appearance. So now, the clinical importance during the transcolumellar incision, we already discussed that the columella part we identify after the raising the columella flap. And if we want to increase the strength, then we use the columella strut. So if you want to increase the strength of this medial crust, then we use for modification of this medial crust, we use the columella strut. So for the columella strut, we use for the tip stability, for the tip projections and the columella shape. We first make a ideally shape of the strut, and then we make the space for the insertion, and we fix it by the sutures. So we can modify the medial crust part by the strut graft. We can fix it with the 26 gauge needle, and we fix by the 50 PDA sutures. So when we examine the patient, this is the importance of the anatomical knowledge. Then if we examine the patient, then we identify that which part of the distort the anatomy. So the entry and exit is the same for the fixation of this strut. So we can create a unified tip by use this strut graft, and we can get the better tip stability and the tip projection and the better columella shape. Now, the second part, that is the middle crust that connect the medial and the lateral crust. So this part have that another, the two segment. One is the dorsal segment, and another is the anteriorly is the lobular segment, and the posteriorly is the anteriorly is the dorsal segment, and posteriorly is the lobular segment. It's a important part of the LR cartilage, because the external appearance of the tip depend on the angulation of the dome and relative width of the two dome and the thickness on the overlying soft tissues. So the shape of the tip is basically dependent on this middle crust part. So the clinical important during the soft triangle, because the dorsal part, this dorsal part of the intermediate crust is thinnest, is narrowest part of the LR cartilage. So posterior to this dorsal part, posterior to this dorsal part, there is a the triangular part, that is a soft triangle part that devoid of the cartilage. Only have the two layer of the soft tissues. One is the skin and the vestibular mucosa. So we always preserve the soft triangle area, because this is an important anterior boundary of the external nasal valve area. Another importance, we control the width of the tip by the interdomal suture, and the angulation of the tip is also we increase by the dome creation sutures. So this is the importance of the middle part of the LR cartilage, intermediate part of the LR cartilage. So this, the ligament and the relation of the medial and the middle crust. This medial and the middle crust tightly bound by the fibrous mesh. This medial crust and the middle crust tightly bound by the interdomal ligament, and anterior most part of this interdomal ligament, that the pitangui ligament, that connect this LR cartilage, this medial and middle crust with the soft tissue envelope. So it's an important ligament, and it is a minor tip support mechanism, but today we presume is as a major tip support mechanism. And another on the cephalate portion of the medial crest, just behind the medial crest, there is septocolumellar ligament that bind the both the medial crest and the medial crest with the caudal septums. That is the membranous septum, because the septum have the three part. One is the bony septum, another is the cartilaginous septum, and another is the membranous septum. So this two middle and the medial crust, this both side of the medial crust and the middle crust structure as a caudal leg of the tripod, because this is the tripod concept or nasal tip, and other two legs of lateral crura, that is the lateral, and that form the other leg of the tripod. Because this in this tripod concept or nasal tip, there is three leg. So the one leg, the central leg, that is formed by the middle and the medial crura, and other two leg that's formed by the lateral crura of the both side of the LR cartilage. So this is the anatomical importance. If we know all these things, then because all the nasal dynamics is dependent on this tripod concept of the nasal tip. Now, this is the abnormality of the middle crest. Ideally, this is the distance between the, because the normal medial crest, normal middle crest have a normal distance around the 4 to 6 mm, and in this case, in the broad tip, then excessive interdomal distance and obtuse dome angle. So this is the abnormality of the middle crest. Now, how can we modify the middle crest? So when we modify the middle crest, then we can use the intradomal suture and the interdomal sutures. If we want to increase the angulation of the dome, then we use the dome crescent suture. This is the intradomal sutures. So this is the horizontal matres sutures at the dome nose. So by this, we can increase the angulation of the dome. So it's a dome crescent suture just to create the more convex dome. So we can modify this intermediate part of the LR cartilage. This is a horizontal matres suture in the domal part, just medial to lateral and then lateral to medial, just to increase the getting for the more definition. So this is the dome crescent sutures. So the dome part of the intermediate crust is important, because the entire shape of the and the width is dependent on this domal part. Another suture that we use, that is the interdomal suture. That means we connect the both sides of the dome, and the never bias and never confuse about the intradomal and interdomal, because like a intercity express that connect the two cities, like the interdomal that connect the two dome. So we by this interdomal suture, we can reduce the depth of width of this medial crust. Now the lateral crust. So this lateral crust is a primary component of the tip lobule, and it's the widest part of the LR cartilage. So it gives the maximum volume of the tip. So this lateral crura gives the maximum volume of the tip, and this lateral crust part of the LR cartilage have the two margin. One is the cephalic margin and another is the caudal margin. So the cephalic margin of this LR cartilage have the attachment with lower part of the upper lateral cartilage, have there is a interlocking, that is the scroll area. So the scroll area is a important tip support mechanism, because the tip have the three tips of major tip support mechanism. One is the size, shape and resilience of this entire LR cartilage, and another that is the attachment of this medial crust with the caudal septum, and third is the scroll area. So this is a important one of major tip support mechanism, this scroll area. And the lower margin, this caudal margin is an important landmark for the marginal incision in open rhinoplasty. So whenever we make the marginal incision, then there is a sometimes for the beginners, for my junior colleagues, they bias where is the ideally site for the marginal incision. So you always palpate in the vestibule this caudal margin of the LR cartilage, caudal margin of the lateral crust by a handle of the knife or a cap of syringe for the marginal incision. So this is the importance of this marginal incision. Now the two things, that is, one is the orientation and another is the contour of this lateral crust is important. The orientation of this lateral crust, this or towards the lateral canthus at around the 45 degree from this midline, but sometimes the patient have the orientation towards the medial canthus, that is the cephalic position of the lower lateral cartilage. So that is the parenthesis deformity. Like rather than the orientation towards the lateral canthus is towards the medial canthus, is less than 45 degree angle. So that is the parenthesis deformity. Another, that is the contour of this lateral crust is also important. The contour of the lateral crust is the convex towards the laterally. So sometimes rather than convex, this lateral crust have the paradoxically curved, lateral crust is concave. So that is the paradoxical curved lateral crust deformity. And another important thing, if a patient have a, like, because this lateral crust have the widest part of the LR cartilage, so it gives the maximum volume to the tip. So if we want to reduce the tip of the patient, then by the cephalic trimming we reduce the volume reduction of the tip. So when we modify the lateral crust by this cephalic trimming, so in the cephalic trimming we excise some part of this lateral crust, the cephalic part of the lateral crust. How much we excise, that is not important. The important thing, how much we preserve, because the mostly Indian patient have the thick skin patients, so at least we preserve around the 6-8 millimeter wide rim strip. Someone have on the microphone. So by this cephalic trimming, we reduce the volume of nasal tip, and for the better hydrodissection, we infiltrate in the vestibular skin for getting the better plane. So this is the cephalic trimming. We can modify the volume of the lateral crust by this cephalic trimming method. And we also increase the malleability of the cartilage for the suturing. So this is the purpose of the cephalic trimming. And this excise part of the lateral crust, we can use for the tip refinement graft. But in thick skin patients, we try to avoid more excision of the cephalic part of the LR cartilage, because later, due to the force of the healing and the force of the contraction, this LR cartilage that is the buckled and collapse. So in thick skin patients, try to preserve as much as around 8 millimeter this rim strip. Now, the another anatomical deformity of the lateral crust in this, the patient have the asymmetrical nasal tip due to the paradoxical convexity of the lateral crust. Ideally, the lateral crust in this area is the convex. So the dome have the convex. Due to the this change in the orientation of this lateral crust, there is distort the smooth contour transection, because for a attractive nose, there is a transition between the dome and the lateral crust area, between the lateral crust area. So due to the collapse of this lateral crust, it disturbed the smooth contour transition and changed the appearance of the tip and alar lobule. And it looked like a pinching of the nasal tip lobule. And because due to the collapse of this alar lobule, it create airway dysfunction, external nasal wall insufficiency. So this is the anatomical abnormality. If we know the normal anatomy, then we identify the abnormal anatomy. If we know the normal anatomy, then we can correct the abnormal anatomy. Now, this is the method to correct it. In this, we use the open approach and we separate this lateral crust from the mid part of this LR cartilage, and then we cut it from the medial and the lateral at the dome junction line, and after the separate this complete lateral crust, then we sectioning at the dome junction line, and we flip it, we around the 180 degree rotate this entire lateral crust, and we suture it with the dome junction line and laterally. For correction of this deformity, we can use the cartilage graft also, but when we use a cartilage graft, only cartilage graft, then have the for the long term, the result is not good, because there is a migration of the chances of the cartilage graft, and due to the mass effect of the cartilage, there is more chance of the functional problem. So this is a anatomical variation of lateral crust, so we can correct by this method, paradoxical curved deformity of the lateral crust. So if we identify the normal anatomy first, then we can correct the abnormal anatomy of the patients. Now, the last, the support of the nasal tip, that is also important. The tip have the, one is the major tip support mechanism, another is the minor tip support mechanism. In the major, one is the size, shape, and resilience of this entire LR cartilage. And the second, that is the connective tissue attachment of the scroll area, the lowermost part of the upper lateral, and the cephalic margin of this LR lateral crust. This is the scroll area, and the attachment of this medial crust with the caudal septum. So this is the major tip support mechanism. And there are another minor tip support mechanism, that is the interdomal ligament, that is the membranous septum, and the sesamoid complex, and the skin and subcutaneous tissues, and the nasal spine. So whenever do the rhinoplasty, then we, all these things we keep in mind for support of the nasal tip. So my take home message, then surgeon should plan the preserve the normal favorable anatomy while correcting the abnormal anatomy, because first you identify the normal anatomy, then you just try to preserve the normal anatomy. Whenever you correct the abnormal anatomy, then try to preserve the normal anatomy. And final excellent rhinoplasty result can only be obtained if surgeon has thorough knowledge of the nasal anatomy and a grasp of the surgical relevance of the alteration of the anatomic structure. Now, this is my fellowship, next fellowship course in the October. So, if you anybody can want to join this, this is a hands-on course for the 4 or 6 people. So, if anyone then you can want to join, then you can go my website. You can find the detail of this course. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sunil, for excellent presentation of abnormal and abnormal anatomy. And it's very important to know the normal anatomy. As you have already mentioned, and it's cleared so many things. Still there's no question from the participants.
Yes, sir.
I just want to ask a few questions because usually that Asian or the Indians, they have thick skins and weak cartilages. So,
yes, sir.
How you take care of that? And what are the
when the patient? When the patient has a thick skin, then definitely first we recognize the patient that is a thick skin patient, and then there are some pre-operative like if the patient have the some sebaceous hypertrophy, or then we there is pre-skin treatment that is important thing. Then and another is the post-surgical also.
Any role of the isotretinoin?
With the dermatologist, if the patient have the sebaceous hypertrophy, because if the patient have the dermal hypertrophy, the dermal problem, then we can use the isotretinoin. But if the patient have the more subcutaneous tissue hypertrophy, in that case, I think there is no role for that.
Thank you. And another question is that what is the importance of the angle requirement and the whole area? Usually when we are doing dissections, we are dividing this. They should be repaired.
Pardon, sir?
During the capillary trim of the lower lateral cartilages, the scroll area is disturbed. So should we repair both the things?
Yes.
Give him a better support to the tip.
Basically, sir, this is an individual perception. I think in the Western people, some people preserve the Pitanguy ligament for create of the supratip break. But I think in the Asian, I think in the Indian people, we have a very thick skin. So I think the supratip break for the there is no role. So I think it doesn't matter, because already we have a thick skin. So in that, I think there is doesn't matter for preserve the Pitanguy ligament. But with the Western literature and the Western for people, they have the thick skin. So in that case, they preserve Pitanguy ligament.
Thank you very much for the excellent presentation. If there's any question, still we can have a question from the participants. If anybody have any queries, you can ask. And then otherwise we will close it. Thank you very much, Sunil.
Thank you, sir.
See you again for
Good
the next
night,
meeting.
Sir.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Good night, sir. Thank you.
There's a question, I think.